Last week, I talked to you about the fact that volatility is up ahead, that there is volatility that's facing us in large part because of the news that I said about the oil prices boiling down to less than zero, and that is precarious. And because of that volatility, we said that jobs are going to be evaporating before our eyes, old practices will be evaporating, old norms, and even old establishments and old rules. When volatility happens, uncertainty is up ahead. In fact, for many of us, this is not even up ahead. We're in it, but it's further down the track. Why is uncertainty something that we can determine as up ahead? We know that the virus, first of all, we were told that it was, if you check the symptoms of people and people were symptomatic, then you can control it. Then we realized that wasn't the case. There were things like asymptomatic. Then we said that the quarantine length was 14 days, and now they're finding that there are times when it goes beyond that. We were told that masks were not necessary, and then masks were necessary. And now we're finding out that the vaccine is about 15 months away, or it could be longer. In short, there's a lot of uncertainty. When you look at flights today, and you think about flights, if you're intending to fly or go on a trip, as I would want to go and visit my children, the reality is there's uncertainty because we don't know if we have contact distancing in planes, how it will look like. And if only a third of a plane can fly or passengers can fly, will the airlines even take us? Uncertainty. Uncertainty now is the new reality. It will be almost like a maze. A maze gives you uncertainty. When things become uncertain, it is very hard to plan things. So the question for us today is, how do you plan in a time of uncertainty? Where do I begin to even start to plan things for my work, for my business, for our ministry, for our personal lives, and for the education of our children? How do I start? Where do I start? Now, the starting point when it comes to planning in uncertain times can be found in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, verse 11. The declaration of these words are, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord." He's declaring it. "Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope," or hope, "and a future." The first word says, "For I know," not "you know," "I know." We don't know, He knows. In other words, that's your starting point. God knows that He has plans for you. And it's not a distant plan, but there's a plan. And the good news is that these plans are to prosper us and to give us a hope and a future. In other words, there is something that we all know this is going to end one day. And in that future, we will find hope and we will find prosperity. God wants to prosper us in the future. And you can only say, yes, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. But here's the interesting thing about that verse. It's the verse that preceded it in verse 10. Verse 10 says, this is what the Lord says, "When 70 years of Babylon are completed." In other words, wait a minute, I thought you had a plan. I didn't realize this was going to be 70 years later. In other words, not just yes, but what? I mean, what is certain in between that time gap? And then he says, when 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come and rescue you. In other words, the level of uncertainty is no longer just uncertainty, it's mega uncertainty. And that's the reality. We know certain things are going to end in the future. We don't know how long, in which case there is a level and a measure of uncertainty. The book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, verse 11, which is a very popular verse we've heard, begins in verse 1. 29 verse 1 says, "This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent." He sent this letter. He was in Jerusalem, from Jerusalem, to the surviving elders, the elders among the exiles. What happened was Nebuchadnezzar, the ruler of Babylon, conquered Israel, took Jehoiakim, Chin, and his mother, and all his wives, and all his wise men, and they were the remaining survivors in this new land of Babylon. I was reminded as I read this verse about the book, The Worst Case Scenario, made popular in the late 1990s. And it says, The Survival Handbook. This is talking about a moment of severe uncertainty for those people in Babylon. And I was reminded about this book and how the accompanying book of the SAS Survival Handbook and How Do You Survive in the End of the World and the Prepper's Survival and the host of survival books that have come after it. What do you do when things are uncertain and survival becomes the name of the game? Verse 1, the second part of verse 1 says, the prophets and all the people, other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. In other words, even the most religious and the most discerning people are uncertain about the future. Now, verse 2 says, this was after King Jehoiachin and the queen mother, even the most authoritative people, the rulers of the land, have no answers. And that's pretty much what we're seeing right now. It is pretty uncertain. The court officials, the smartest leaders of Judah, have no answer. And even the part of Jerusalem, and even the skilled workers and artisans had gone into exile from Jerusalem. No one has the answer. Here's the situation. Israel and Judah were sacked. They were uncertain about the present, and they were uncertain about the future. The question, therefore, is how does God want you to plan in a time of uncertainty? Verse 4 says, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those who are carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This is what God is saying to you in a moment of uncertainty. Now, I want you to understand something when you read the Bible. When you read these things, this is not written to you. This is written for a specific people. When you read the Bible, you don't take these words and put meaning in them. You take the principle of uncertainty and what God says to those people, you extract that principle and you apply it to your life here today. Now, to all those who were carried into exile, in other words, very uncertain times. As I prepared for this message, I phoned an 86-year-old man who has been through SARS in Singapore and who has been through different kinds of uncertainties. And I had a moment to talk to him about uncertainty. I asked him, tell me about the most uncertain moments in your life. And I say, and he didn't reference the SARS. He referenced to me World War II. He said he was 9 years old when World War II broke out. And he actually asked me, how old were you when that happened? I said, I was not born. I'm only 63 years old. I wanted to know from people who've been through things, what uncertainty looks like. And he said they were uncertain about surviving the war. Bombs were dropping all over Singapore. And they weren't even sure they were going to survive. They were uncertain about surviving during the occupation of the invaders. Uncertainty. How were we going to eat? And then, most of all, after the war, they were uncertain about the post-war future. What does the future hold for us? Uncertainty. It was an interesting moment just to talk to him because he was very similar to what we're going through. Uncertain about surviving COVID-19. Hopefully, most of us will. Uncertain about thriving in the occupation is uncertain about thriving during the COVID-19 situation. And then, most of all, uncertain about the post-COVID-19 future. What's that going to look like? Are jobs going to be there? Are our norms going to be there? The things we've gotten used to? Now, verse 4 says, the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those carried from Jerusalem to Babylon. Here's the interesting thing. Here's what God says to them in that letter, beginning, which ends somewhere in verse 11. I know the plans for you. He begins by saying, build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Interesting. The first thing he says in the moment of uncertainty is build. Not just build. He said, build houses in a foreign land, in a foreign situation. In our case, start building in the midst of this uncertainty and settle down. Then he goes on to say, plant gardens to eat what they produce. In other words, if you're uncertain of surviving COVID-19, plan to survive. That's the beginning thing. God has plans for you in the future, but right now, what he's telling us is plan to survive. He says, build houses. Make a plan to build the house or build your physical needs right now. And then he says, plant a garden. In other words, build for your physical needs. What are your physical needs right now? And begin to build for that. Begin to build. I'm back to exercising. It's been 12 weeks of really running around and trying to figure out what the next evolution of life looks like in the midst of COVID, where my schedules have gotten lost. I had to rebuild. And that idea of building for your physical needs right now differs from person to person. Some of you, it's about your job. Some of you, it's about your health. Some of you, it's about, for my 88-year-old mother, whom I spoke to earlier this week, it's a very different situation. She's in a lockdown all by herself with a household help and a dog. My sister, she's living with my sister, who happens to be stranded in somewhere in Florida. But build for your physical needs. And address that, because that's necessary for you to survive. Next is Proverbs 22 verse 3 says, the prudent see danger and they take refuge. This is not the time to be a daredevil. This is the time to be prudent for your physical life. Don't expose yourself unnecessarily. But the simple keep going and pay the penalty. In other words, they suffer for it, another version says. Don't just build for your physical needs. Build prudently as you go on with life. This is not the same scenario. This is the different. In fact, I dare say, none of us have ever experienced anything like this magnitude, apart from my friend, my 86-year-old friend, who has been through war. 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 6 says, in all this you greatly rejoice, though not for now a little time, while you may have had to suffer grief of all kinds. In other words, build to endure, build with endurance. You're going to have to endure. There will be suffering, although for a short period of time, but be ready to build for your physical needs, be ready to build prudently, and build with endurance. The 1828 dictionary speaks of endurance as a noun. It says, a bearing or suffering, a continuing under pain of distress without resistance. This is the time, and here's the problem with the coming generation. Because of years and years and years of not learning how to survive, back in the day of my friend, people knew how to survive. People knew that that was the way to go. And that's why they know how to endure. Generation that's coming up know how to enjoy. They were never trained how to endure. And at this moment in life, you need to have endurance. The ability to bear the suffering, continuing under pain or distress without resisting. Or without sinking or yielding to the pressure. In other words, don't give in to the pressure. The ability to delay and wait for the future that will come. It will come, but there will be a delay. Now, question for you. Do you have a survival plan for your physical needs? How do you plan to build it? Do you have a plan? Is there a plan that you're changing? I'm back to shaving again because I'm stuck in the house. I had to redo my plans, my physical plans, because I need to survive. And that context for you is different as it is for me. Now, back to the question, how does God want you to plan in a time of uncertainty? He says, I have plans for you, plans to prosper you, plans to give you hope, plans to give you a future. But that's in the future. For now, plan to survive. Now, what do you do when you're uncertain about thriving during the actual COVID? Well, the second thing is plan to thrive. Not just survive, but to thrive. There's a difference between surviving and thriving. You're not going to last very long if all you're doing is trying to survive. At some point, you've got to shift from surviving to thriving. And that's why you have to first plan to survive. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 6 says, Mary and have sons and daughters. It's a funny thing how this letter, if you want to read this tonight, the Bible is an amazing book. And it says, marry and have sons and daughters. He says, find wives for your sons and daughters in marriage so that you may have sons, so that you too may have, they too may have sons and daughters. And basically, he said, if thriving or surviving is about enduring, if surviving is about endurance, thriving is all about securing your relationships. If you want to thrive, the next phase, after you've addressed the physical needs, is address your relational issues. Notice what chapter 29, verse 6 says, increase in number there, do not decrease. In other words, he was saying, don't just build houses, don't just plant gardens, don't just survive, thrive. Increase in number, grow again. I know that you've sinned against me. I know that you've made bad decisions. I know that you've been caught flat-footed in this season, but you can change that. Thrive. Build your relationships. Build your key relationships. This is the season. A friend of mine from Singapore had an interesting story. He sent me this video of his daughter, 7-year-old daughter. And she is singing to, I don't want to play the long video, but she's singing to the praise and worship of our service. And he told me the story about how this daughter of hers prayed that, God, would you give my, she actually listens to me preach. She said, would you please make my mom and dad spend more time with me at home? And that night that they were praying together during the COVID, she said, God, thank you for answering my prayers. And my friend had to literally get up there and turn, and just in his heart of hearts, he realized God answers prayer. And he began to say how much he enjoyed the last few weeks, if not the last few months, being with her. This is a moment to rebuild your relationships. And we're all in different places. I've been rebuilding my relationships with my grandchildren. That's my oldest grandson, and that's me and my wife trying to connect with him online. These are my two grandchildren who are serving me food. That's not even edible. And my other grandson and this bald-headed cutie. The point is, rebuild your relationship. For you, that's different. That may be a husband. That may be a wife. That may be a parent. That may be an office mate. That may be somebody. That may be your professional relationships. Build them now. After you've planned to survive, plan to thrive. Secondly, build your attitude. Your attitude is going to matter the most in this season. It's the difference between whether you're going to have fun or this is going to be something that's going to be a horrible next few months. There's a difference between enduring and thriving. Enduring means I don't have a choice. That's what survival is. Back in the days when people didn't have all the conveniences we have, we needed to endure. We had no choice. Today, because we have all these choices, we don't know how to endure. But enduring is not thriving. Enduring is I have no choice. Thriving is I choose to be a blessing. I choose to be a good person. I choose to be good-natured. It's a choice. It's not an easy choice, but if you're going to thrive, you're going to have to change your attitude. You can say, I don't have a choice. This is my new job now. I've got to deliver. I've got to be a Grab driver or whatever it is you're saying. I don't have a choice. Yes, but you can choose to work well. You can choose to say thank you. You can choose to be grateful. You can choose to say, God, I thank you, I'm still alive. Because that is thriving and no longer just surviving. Enduring will cause you to just grumble and complain over time. Thriving will say, I can turn this moment into an advantage. I can turn this moment to a time when I can influence others and be a blessing to many. I can turn this time to an advantage for me that other people will see that. By the way, if you don't realize this, we're all on equal level right now. The opportunities for everybody is the same. This is the time to turn this negative situation into an advantage for you. Enduring will just make you ungrateful over time. Thriving will make you grateful and say, God, thank you. I breathe, I have strength, I have resources, I have friends, I have key relationships, I'm ready for the future, I'm just waiting for it to happen. Verse 7 says, and also seek peace and prosperity of the city which you've been carried to exile. Basically, they were saying, hey, listen, guys, you're stuck there already. Pray for peace and prosperity, because here's the reason why. You can't just build your key relationships and build your attitude. You got to build for prosperity. And you can't build something that prospers and blossoms and thrives if you don't have peace and prosperity. You can't. And you can't just keep going on surviving. We were not meant to just be survivors. We were meant to be like trees planted by streams of water, whose leaves do not wither, who bear fruit in season, who whatever we do will prosper. That is God's dream for you. But you need to plan to thrive. 3 John chapter 1, verse 2 says, Beloved, I pray that in all respects you may prosper and be in good health, just as your soul prospers. I love this verse. I pray that in all respects, prosperity is not just money, Prosperity is not just being healthy. Prosperity is not just having, prosperity is all of those combined together. And that's why you want to pray that you would be like a tree planted in streams of water, that whatever you do will prosper, that you would be in good health. And the key, it says, is your soul is prosperous. When your soul is prosperous, you achieve prosperity. The question for you and me is this. Do you have a plan to thrive in your relationships? Where are the details of that plan? As I try and land this message, it's the letter that Jeremiah wrote, the survivors, was just a plan to survive, plan to thrive. He said, if you don't know what the future is, plan with God. I love this part. Closing letters or the closing moments or of the letter goes, Jeremiah 29 verse 8 is, he says, this is what the Lord Almighty God of Israel says, do not let the prophets and the diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to their dreams that encourage, that do you encourage them to have. Basically, you're feeding on each other. Don't just listen to any voice. Discern from me and walk with me. And then we arrive at verse 10. When the 70 years have been completed of Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my promise to bring you back to this place. That's where we started a while ago. Plan to thrive in this uncertainty. Plan to survive, rather. Plan to thrive. And more importantly, plan with God. Because He knows the plans. There are very rare verses in the Bible where a word is used three times in succession. This is one of them. Because God is serious in letting you know He has a plan for you. And His plan for you is a hope in the future and prosperity. And then it goes on, as the closing moments of this letter, or the best parts of this letter, verse 12, then you will call on me, and you will pray to me, and I will listen to you. And as you do that, because you've planned to survive and thrive and walk to me with my plans, you will seek me and you will find me. And when you seek me with all your heart, that's actually ultimately what God wants you to gain from this moment. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity to the place which I ordained for you. As I close, show you a picture of my 88-year-old mother with my sister's dog and having that conversation with her and telling me about her dentures fell and she needs to survive. And she found some kind of glue to piece it together and she survived. But she's thriving. She's picking up plants and trying to do a little bit of gardening all by herself. But most of all, I love what she said. Joey, I'm ready to go. I'm ready for Jesus. And I put my life in the hands of our God. That's the game plan. As you meditate on the Word of God, think about these things. Think about the plans that God has for you. I want to pray a prayer that summarizes the message we just heard. Lord Jesus, You are our hope. You are our hope and our prosperity and our future. Though we may have many plans, we trust that it is Your purposes that will prevail. We proclaim that we can do all things. We can do all things, not just survive, not just thrive, but well into the future through You, Jesus, who gives us strength. We will not just survive, but thrive. And as we commit our plans to You, we know that they will succeed. We also trust, Jesus, that we trust that You will supply all our needs through Your glorious riches. Lord, it's not very easy to look to the future with a lot of uncertainty. But we thank You that You're here for us. And in You, Jesus' name, in Your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.